Recorded Books and RB Digital present Banana Cream Pie Murder by Joanne Fluke, narrated by Suzanne Toren. Chapter 1. Dolores Swensen typed "the end" and gave a smile of satisfaction as she leaned back in her desk chair. She'd finished the manuscript for her newest Regency romance novel. She was just about to get up and open the bottle of Perrier Jouet she'd been saving for this occasion when she heard a loud crack and she fell to the floor backwards. For one stunned moment, she stared up at the ceiling in her office in disbelief, unable to move or make a sound. She blinked several times and moved her head tentatively. Nothing hurt. She was still alive. But what had happened? And why had she fallen over backwards? When the obvious solution occurred to her, Dolores started to giggle. The loud crack had sounded when the cushioned seat of her desk chair had sheared off from its base. It was something Doc had warned her would happen someday if she didn't get around to replacing it. And she hadn't. And it had. And here she was on her back, her body effectively swaddled by soft, stuffed leather, barely able to move a muscle. As she realized that she was in the same position as a turtle flipped over on its back, Dolores began to laugh even harder. It was a good thing no one was here to see her. She must look ridiculous. That meant she had to figure out some way to get up before Doc came home. If he saw her like this, she'd never hear the end of it. And she wouldn't put it past him to take a photo of her stuck in the chair on her back and show it to everyone at the hospital. Unsure of exactly how to extricate herself, Dolores braced her hands on the cushioned arms of the chair and pushed. This didn't work the way she'd thought it would, but it did work. Instead of moving her body backwards, her action pushed the chair forward. The part of her body that Doc referred to as her gluteus maximus was now several inches away from the seat of the chair, far enough for her to bend her legs, hook her heels on the edge of the chair seat, and push it even farther away. She was getting there. Dolores pushed with her heels again, and the chair slid several more inches away. By repeating this motion and squirming on her back at the same time, she somehow managed to free herself from her cushioned prison and roll over on hands and knees. She got to her feet by grasping the edge of her desk and pulling herself upright. When she was in a standing position, Dolores gave a sigh of relief and promised herself that she'd buy a new desk chair in the morning. Now that she was on her feet again, and none the worse for wear, she decided that celebratory champagne was a necessity. She took the prized bottle from the dorm refrigerator Doc had insisted she install in her office and opened it with a soft pop. Loud pops were for movie scenes. She'd learned to remove the cork slowly so that not even a drop would escape. Dolores set the open bottle on the desk and went to close the window. She liked fresh air, and she always opened it when she worked in the office. She was about to close it when she heard a blood-curdling scream from the floor below. For a moment, Dolores just stood there, a shocked expression on her face. Then she glanced at the clock and realized it was a few minutes past 8 in the evening. The scream must have come from one of Tori's acting students. The luxury condo immediately below the penthouse Doc had given her as a wedding present was owned by Victoria Bascomb, Mayor Bascomb's sister. Tori, as she preferred to be called, had been a famous Broadway actress. She'd recently retired and moved to Lake Eden to be closer to the only family she had left, her brother Richard and his wife Stephanie. Unable to completely divorce herself from the life she loved, Tori had volunteered to direct their local theater group, to teach drama at Jordan High, and to give private acting lessons to any Lake Edenite who aspired to take the theater world by storm. If not the richest, Tori Bascomb was undeniably the most famous person in town. Just yesterday, Tori had told Dolores that she had won the Lifetime Achievement Award from STAG, the Stage and Theater Actors Guild, and she would receive her award, a gold statuette that resembled a male deer, at a nationally televised award ceremony soon. Dolores gave a little laugh. How silly she'd been to forget that Tori gave acting lessons in her home studio. The scream she'd heard was obviously part of an acting lesson. Smiling a bit at her foolishness, Dolores reached out again, intending to close and lock the window, but a loud cry made her pause in mid-motion.
"No!" a female voice screamed. "Don't! Please don't!"
Whoever the aspiring actress was, she was very good. Dolores began to push the window closed when she heard a sound unlike any other. A gunshot. That was a gunshot. She was sure of it. The gunshot was followed by a second gunshot, and then a crash from the floor below. Something was wrong. No acting student could be that realistic. This was really happening. Dolores didn't think. She just reacted. She raced for the doorway that led to the back stairway that had been used by hotel employees before the Albion Hotel had been converted into luxury condos. The old stairway had been completely refurbished and accessible exclusively to the penthouse residents. When Dolores arrived at the landing of the floor below, she unlocked the door and rushed out into the narrow lobby that separated the two condos on the floor below the penthouse. She raced to Tori's door, and only then did the need for caution cross her mind. Dolores stood there, the key Tori had given her in her hand, and listened. All was quiet inside Tori's condo, no sounds at all. If what she'd heard had been an acting lesson, Tori should be speaking to the would-be actress, critiquing the scene she'd just performed. As Dolores continued to listen for sounds, she considered her options. She'd look very foolish if she unlocked the door and stepped inside to find that Tori and her student were perfectly fine. On the other hand, she could be walking into danger if what she'd heard was a real murder and the intruder was still there. If she called the police before she went in, they'd advise her to wait until they got there. But what if someone needed immediate medical attention? Dolores hesitated for another moment or two, and then she decided to knock. She might feel foolish if Tori came to the door and said that everything was fine, but it couldn't hurt to check. She raised her hand and knocked sharply 3 times. There was no answer, and she heard no rushing footfalls as the intruder hurried to a hiding place. There were no sounds from inside at all. Dolores hesitated for another moment, and then she made a decision. She reached into her pocket, pulled out her cell phone, and dialed the emergency number for the Winnetka County Sheriff's Station.
Sheriff's Station, Detective Kingston speaking.
Dolores took a deep breath. She'd been hoping to contact her son-in-law, Bill Todd, but instead she'd gotten Mike. He was a by-the-book cop, and he'd tell her to stay outside the door and wait for him to get there.
"Mike, it's Dolores," she said, thinking fast. "Stay on the line, will you, please? I heard a sound from Tori Bascom's condo, and I'm going in to make sure everything's all right."
"Dolores, I want you to wait until—"
Dolores unlocked the door with one hand and pushed it open. Then, holding the phone away from her ear so she wouldn't hear Mike's objections, she glanced around Tori's living room. Nothing was out of place. No overturned chairs, no strangers lurking in corners, no sign of anything unusual. But the scream she'd heard hadn't come from the living room. It had come from the room directly below her office, and that was the room that Tori had converted into her acting studio. Dolores moved toward the studio silently, holding the phone in her left hand. It was still sputtering and squawking, but she ignored it. As she prepared to open the door, she spotted a piece of artwork on a table in the hallway. It was made of a heavy metal, probably silver, and it resembled a thin but curvaceous lady holding her arms aloft. Dolores grabbed it. It was just as heavy as it looked,
and it would serve as a weapon if the occasion warranted. The door to the studio was slightly open, and Dolores peeked in. The focus of the room was the U-shaped couch facing a low platform handcrafted of cherry wood. The platform was one step high and ran the length of the opposite wall, forming a stage for Tori's would-be actors and actresses. The couch served as Tori's throne. It was where she sat to observe her students. Dolores had sat there one afternoon, and she knew it was made of baby-soft, butterscotch-colored leather. A fur throw was draped over the back of the couch. Dolores hadn't asked Tori which particular animals had given their lives to create the fur throw, but she suspected that it had been very expensive and was probably made from Russian sable. The scene that presented itself did not look threatening, so Dolores stepped into the studio. The indirect lighting that covered the ceiling bathed the studio in a soft glow. Dolores glanced at the round coffee table in front of the couch and drew in her breath sharply. A bottle of champagne was nestled in a silver wine bucket next to the table, and a crystal flute filled with champagne sat on the table next to a distinctive bakery box that Dolores immediately recognized. It was a bakery box from the Cookie Jar, the bakery and coffee shop that her eldest daughter owned. The lid was open, and Dolores could tell that it contained one of Hannah's banana cream pies. It was Tori's favorite pie, and she'd told Dolores that she often served it when she had guests. The flute filled with champagne was interesting. Clouds of tiny bubbles were rising to the surface, and that meant it had been poured quite recently. Dolores knew, through personal experience, that the bubbles slowed and eventually stopped as time passed. Two crystal dessert plates were stacked on the coffee table, along with two silver dessert forks. It was obvious that Tori had been expecting a guest. Dolores set the phone down on the couch and stared at the coffee table. The puzzle it presented was similar to the homework that her daughters had brought home from kindergarten, a photocopied sheet of paper with a picture drawn in detail. The caption had been, "What is wrong with this picture?" Something was wrong with Tori's coffee table. What was it? The answer occurred to Dolores almost immediately. Tori had set out two dessert plates and two dessert forks, but only one flute of champagne. That was a puzzling omission. Dolores knew that Tori loved champagne, and judging by the label that was peeking out of the ice bucket, this was very good champagne. Did this mean that Tori was imbibing? But her anticipated guest was not? Or had Tori filled her own champagne glass and carried it away to drink someplace else in the condo? And that question was followed by an even more important question. Where was Tori? Dolores was dimly aware that hissing and crackling sounds were coming from her phone. Mike was still talking to her, but his words were undecipherable, muffled by the fact she'd placed her cell phone down on the cushions of the couch. Dolores ignored it and glanced around the studio again. Her gaze reached the floor near the back of the couch and halted, focusing on that area. The white plush wall-to-wall carpet looked wet. Something had been spilled there. Dolores moved toward the wet carpet. She rounded the corner of the couch and stopped, reaching out to steady herself as she saw a sight that she knew would haunt her dreams for years to come. Tori was sprawled on the rug, a sticky red stain on one of the beautiful silk caftans she wore on evenings that she worked at home. The stain on the caftan glistened in the light from the tiny bulbs in the ceiling. Dolores shuddered as she saw the crystal champagne flute tipped on its side on the floor, its expensive contents now permanently embedded in the plush white fibers. Thank goodness the blood hadn't gotten on the carpet. That could have permanently ruined it. She'd have to give Tori the name of a good carpet cleaning firm so that they could remove the champagne stain.
Oh!
Dolores gave a cry that ended in a sob. Tori wouldn't need the name of a carpet cleaner. Tori would never need anything again. Tori was dead. Her friend was dead. Tears began to fall from her eyes, but Dolores couldn't seem to look away. Her friend's eyes seemed fixed on the ceiling, and her mouth was slightly open, as if she were protesting the cruel twist of fate that had befallen her.
"It's okay, Dolores. We are here."
The sound of a calm male voice released Dolores from her horrid fixation, and she managed to turn to face the sound. It was Mike, and he had brought Lonnie with him. They had both come to help her. She wanted to thank them, but she couldn't seem to find the words.
"Lonnie's going to take you back upstairs and stay with you until Michelle comes."
"Michelle's still here?" Dolores recovered enough to ask about her youngest daughter. "I thought she was going back to college tonight."
"She was, but she decided to stay until Hannah and Ross get back. I'll be up later to take your statement."
As Lonnie took her arm, Dolores began to shake. It was as if she had been hit with a blast of icy winter wind. She leaned heavily on Lonnie's arm as he led her from the room, from the awful sight of the friend she'd never see again, the friend who wouldn't come over for coffee in the morning, the downstairs neighbor who would no longer sit by the pool under the climate-controlled dome in Dolores and Doc's penthouse garden and chat about her career on the stage. Tori would never collect her Lifetime Achievement Award and hear the applause of her peers. Victoria Bascom's stellar life had ended, and Dolores was overwhelmed with grief and sadness. As she entered the penthouse on Lonnie's arm and sank onto the soft cushions of the couch, another emotion began to grow in her mind. It replaced the heaviness of her sadness, at least for the moment. That emotion was anger. Anger that her friend had died in such a senseless manner. How dare someone come into Tori's home and hurt her? As Dolores sat there waiting for Michelle to arrive, she was filled with a fiery resolve. She had to tell Hannah that Tori had been murdered. The moment that Michelle arrived, they had to try to reach Hannah. They needed her, and she had to help them. Her eldest daughter would know where to start and what to do. Hannah had to come home to Lake Eden immediately so that they could find Tori's killer and make him pay for the horrible crime he had committed. Chapter 2. Hannah Swensen Barton sat on the balcony of the owner's suite, a chilled glass of champagne in her hand. She gave a happy smile as she watched the sun sink lower in the sky. The gentle lapping of the waves created a rhythm of contentment in her heart, and she knew that she'd never felt so joyous and fulfilled. Marriage was wonderful. She loved Ross with every fiber of her being, and she truly felt one with him. At the same time, she was happy to be alone for a few moments, to rediscover herself as a person and not half of a couple. She'd missed her alone time in the early morning, sitting at her kitchen table in her old nightgown, sipping coffee and letting her mind gather the energy to deal with the day ahead. Early morning and late night were the times that her creative juices flourished, unchecked by the necessity of making conversation. Those were the times when she came up with ideas for new recipes, for improvements she could make at the cookie jar, for wonderfully personalized gifts she could make or buy for her family. Of course, there were times when solitude was lonely, but she'd been with Ross for every waking moment of their honeymoon. There was no denying that it had been wonderful, but it had also felt just a bit confining. Perhaps even... Hannah stopped herself in mid-thought and attempted to ignore the word that had flashed in her mind. That word was stifling. Not all of the time, certainly not, but occasionally she needed some room to think and to breathe. She took a sip of her champagne. She didn't really want it, but Ross had poured it for her, and he'd think that she didn't like it if her glass was still untouched. She rose to her feet, walked to the second bathroom that their butler had called the powder room, and poured half of the champagne down the drain. On her way back to the balcony, she felt a bit disloyal. Ross had chosen the champagne especially for her. It wasn't that she didn't like it, she did. It was just that she didn't feel like drinking it now, on the last night of their cruise. She wanted to savor every moment, to stock up the memories for later, for after they'd returned to their lives in Lake Eden. The sun was almost down, and it cast a golden path across the sea, a glistening bridge between day and night. Hannah looked up and smiled as she realized the stars were beginning to appear in the sky. They seemed to be bigger and more brilliant out here on the ocean than they ever had in Lake Eden. Going on a cruise was a wonderful adventure, and she hoped that they could afford to do it again sometime. "I'm back, honey." A voice spoke behind her, and Hannah almost jumped.
"Ross, I didn't hear you come in. Is everything all right with the purser?"
"Everything's fine. They just charged us for a couple of things we didn't get, like the shore excursions we canceled in Cabo."
"Oh."
Hannah blushed, hoping that he couldn't see it in the twilight of the approaching night. She remembered precisely why they had stayed in their stateroom and hadn't gone on their planned shore excursion. "I straightened it all out, and while I was at it, I made reservations at the French bistro for tonight."
Hannah began to frown. "But I thought we were just going to stay here. After those appetizers you ordered from the butler, I'm not really very hungry."
"You don't have to be hungry. Their portions are small. I checked it out when I walked by, and I made sure we have a great table by the window. Their cuisine looked really good, and I thought you'd enjoy going there."
"Oh, I'm sure I will," Hannah said quickly, realizing that Ross had sounded a bit disappointed that she wasn't more enthusiastic. "What time is our reservation, and is it a dress-up place?"
Ross glanced at his watch. "We've got a half hour before we have to leave, and it's not formal, but it's something the hostess called smart casual. What you have on is fine, Cookie."
Hannah glanced down at her black pants and aqua blue sweater. If she changed her shoes, put on some jewelry, and covered her sweater with the black jacket she'd brought, she should pass for smart casual.
"It'll only take a moment or two for me to get ready." "We've got plenty of time."
Ross picked up her half-filled glass.
"I'll top this off and get a glass for myself."
Hannah watched him as he went back inside. Ross anticipated what he thought were her needs, and sometimes he was wrong.
But she supposed that was better than not being concerned at all. She chided herself for being too picky.
She was probably just not used to all this attention. She'd been single for years now, living alone except for her cat, Moisha, and she was used to taking care of herself. She should be grateful for the way Ross lavished attention on her. As she sat there, waiting for the champagne she didn't really want, Hannah told herself that things would be very different when they got back to Lake Eden. Then they would have their separate careers, and they wouldn't be together 24 hours a day. It was entirely possible she'd miss this time and regret that she hadn't been more grateful to the man who obviously loved her so much.
"Here you go, Cookie."
Ross stepped out on the balcony carrying the two champagne glasses and a piece of paper.
"Our butler was just here and he brought this."
"What is it?"
"A message from your sister, Michelle. The butler said it just came in."
Hannah's heart began to pound as she reached out for the paper that Ross was holding.
"I hope everything's okay," he said, echoing Hannah's own thoughts.
And then he noticed that her hands were shaking.
"Are you all right, honey?"
"I think so." Hannah's fingers touched the paper, but she couldn't seem to grasp it, and it dropped to the balcony floor.
"Do you want me to read it for you?"
Ross asked, picking it up.
"Your hands are shaking."
"Yes. Thank you, Ross." Hannah said gratefully, praying that nothing bad had happened to her mother or her sisters or Moishe or anyone else in her extended family.
We're all okay, including Moishe, but Mother wanted to give you a heads up before you get home to Lake Eden, Ross read aloud.
Hannah realized that she'd been holding her breath, and she let it out in a relieved sigh.
Thank goodness. Go on, Ross, please.
Victoria Bascomb is dead. She was murdered, and Mother found her body. She's shaken up, of course, and she wants you to come home right away.
Oh, dear, Hannah said, beginning to frown. We're taking the shuttle to the airport when we dock, aren't we, Ross?
Of course. I made those arrangements online before we left Lake Eden. Miss Bascomb was your mother's neighbor, wasn't she?
Yes. She lived one floor down from Mother and Doc's penthouse. I wonder if Mother heard something.
Yes, she did. It's in the next sentence. Ross began to read again. Mother heard a gunshot and went downstairs to check on Tori. She says to tell you she thinks Tori knew her killer and let him or her in because she had one of your banana cream pies and two dessert plates out on the coffee table.
Hannah groaned. So my baked goods were at the murder scene again?
I'm afraid so. I'm sorry, honey.
Ross handed her the paper, and then he lifted her to her feet to hug her.
Do you want me to cancel our dinner reservations?
Hannah thought about that for a moment, and then she shook her head. No. I'm sorry that Mother had to find Tori's body, and I can understand why she's so upset. It must have been a terrible shock. And of course, Mother wants me to investigate.
But are you upset?
Murder always upsets me. The idea that one person can callously take another person's life is horrible. But if you're asking if I felt a personal connection to Tori, the answer is no. I know she was Mother's friend and neighbor, but I really didn't know her that well.
Ross looked down at her searchingly. I think I understand, honey. What I was really wondering is if you're upset that one of your pies was found at the murder scene.
Hannah took a moment to assess her true feelings. Yes and no. While it's true that I don't like my baked goods associated with murder, Tori was crazy about my banana cream pie.
She bought at least two every week. But a lot of your baked goods have been found at murder scenes, haven't they?
Hannah sighed as she nodded. Ross was right. Ron, their cozy cow delivery man, had been eating one of her chocolate chip crunch cookies when he'd been shot. And her strawberry shortcake Swensen had been spilled all over Danielle Watson's garage when Coach Watson had been murdered. Then there was Connie Mack, who'd been in Hannah's walk-in cooler at the cookie jar, filching one of Hannah's blue blueberry muffins when she'd met her end. And deliberately, Hannah pushed those thoughts out of her mind. She didn't want to think about the number of times something she'd baked had been present at someone's violent demise.
You're right, Ross, she admitted. But that's understandable if you think about it. I'm the only baker in Lake Eden, and almost everyone who lives there loves desserts. If they don't make desserts themselves, they buy them from the cookie jar. It's a little like saying that clothing leads to murder because the victim is usually wearing it at the murder scene.
So you don't feel bad about your banana cream pie being right there?
Hannah sighed. Ross was like a dog with a bone. He didn't seem capable of letting the idea go. She could feel herself prickling with irritation, but she pushed that emotion back. No, I don't feel bad. Not really, not if she wasn't actually eating the pie when she was killed. It's a great pie, and it's very popular in Lake Eden.
Then you're not going to stop baking it just because it was there when someone was killed?
No, I won't stop baking it. I refuse to give in to superstition. I'll make as many as my customers want to buy.
Good.
Ross looked very relieved, and Hannah was puzzled. Why were you so concerned that I might take it off the cookie jar menu?
Because I've never tasted it. And banana cream pie is one of my very favorite pies.
Hannah gave a little laugh. All right, then. I'll bake one for you when we get back to Lake Eden.
Thanks, Hannah.
Ross gave her another hug, and then he released her to glance at his watch.
If you're going to freshen up, you'd better do it now. If we don't leave here in a couple of minutes, we'll lose our dinner res...
He stopped in mid-sentence.
Is it still okay if we go out to dinner?
We can go. I'll be just fine. As long as you promise me one thing.
What is it, Cookie?
If they happen to have banana cream pie on the dessert menu, promise me that you won't order it. I want you to taste mine first.
Hannah's banana cream pie. Salted pretzel crust, banana cream pie filling, whipped caramel topping. Hannah's first note. Make the crust first. It has to cool before you put in the filling. Once the filling is in place, the pie must set before you make the whipped caramel topping. Salted pretzel crust. Preheat oven to 350 degrees Fahrenheit, rack in the middle position. 2 cups finely crushed salted pretzels. Measure after crushing. This will take approximately 3/4 of a 16-ounce bag of salted thin stick pretzels. I used Snyder's original stick pretzels. 1/2 cup, 4 ounces, 1 stick, 1/4 pound, salted butter, melted. 2 tablespoons, 1/8 cup, firmly packed brown sugar. Before you start to make the crust, prepare a 9-inch round springform pan, the kind you'd use to make cheesecake with a clamp on the side that you can release to lift out the bottom. Spray the inside of the pan with Pam or another nonstick baking spray. Mix the 2 cups of crushed salted pretzels with the melted butter and the brown sugar. Mix until thoroughly combined. Hannah's second note. You can crush the pretzels by putting them in a Ziploc bag and using a rolling pin, but it's a lot easier if you put them in a food processor and use the steel blade in an on and off motion. Place the crust mixture into the bottom of the pan you've chosen. Using your impeccably clean hands, press it down as evenly as you can over the bottom and 2 inches up the sides. Bake your pretzel crumb crust at 350 degrees Fahrenheit for 10 to 12 minutes or until lightly browned. Take your crust out of the oven and let it cool on a cold stovetop burner or a wire rack for at least an hour. Longer is fine, too. I've made my crust the day before I made the rest of the pie. If you do this, cover your crust loosely, but do not refrigerate it. Banana cream pie filling. 2 perfectly ripe bananas, yellow with no black spots on the peel. 2 packages, 4 serving size each, instant vanilla pudding. I used Jell-O. 2 1/4 cups cold whole milk. 1/4 cup rum. I used Bacardi. 1 cup thawed whipped topping. I used Cool Whip. Hannah's first note. Use a rum that's colorless for a prettier pie. Hannah's second note. If you'd like to make this recipe alcohol-free, simply use 2 1/2 cups of whole milk and forget about the rum in a bowl. To assemble the pie, slice the banana into 1/4-inch rounds and place the banana slices in the bottom of the completely cooled pretzel crust. Mix the 2 packages of dry instant vanilla pudding with the milk and the rum in a bowl. Beat for 2 minutes with a whisk or a slotted spoon until the pudding has thickened. Add the 1 cup of thawed whipped topping to the pudding and mix it in. Don't overmix, or you'll mix out all the air in the topping. The air will give your pie volume and make it look prettier. Spoon the pudding mixture into the pretzel crust and smooth it out with a rubber spatula. Cover your partially completed pie loosely with a sheet of aluminum foil or with wax paper.
Then place the springform pan inside the refrigerator for 4 hours to set. Whipped caramel topping. 1 cup whipped topping thawed. I used thawed Cool Whip. 1/3 cup caramel ice cream topping at room temperature. I used Smucker's. Place the whipped topping in a bowl. With a rubber spatula, fold in the caramel ice cream topping until it is well combined. Rinse off the rubber spatula, dry it, and frost the top of your banana cream pie with the caramel whipped topping. Once your pie is frosted, touch the side of your rubber spatula to the top of the whipped caramel topping and pull it up quickly. Use the same motion you'd use to make points in the meringue all over the top of a pie. Let your pie sit in the refrigerator, uncovered, for another 30 minutes or longer before you prepare to serve it. You can garnish the top of your pie by drizzling on more of the caramel ice cream topping. Remove your pie from the pan by releasing the catch on the side and lifting off the ring. Leave the pie on the bottom of the pan and simply place it on a flat platter. Either cut the pie and serve it at the table, or cut it in the kitchen and place the pieces on pretty dessert plates. Serve with plenty of strong, hot coffee. This pie is very rich and luscious. If there is any leftover pie, which there probably won't be sure to keep it refrigerated. This pie will keep for several days in the refrigerator. Yield 8 to 12 slices of delicious pie, depending on the width of your slices. Chapter 3. Hannah leaned back in the cushioned chair and smiled at her new husband. Thanks to Ross, getting off the ship had been easy. Their owner's suite had entitled them to an escort, and they'd been the first passengers to get off the ship. Their luggage had been waiting for them, complete with a porter and cart, and they'd gone out to the street just in time to catch a shuttle to the airport. Once they'd gone through the airport security check, they had been escorted to the VIP lounge, where a uniformed waitress had seated them at a table and taken their breakfast orders. They'd eaten a delicious breakfast, which had been followed by a pot of excellent coffee, and then they'd relaxed in lounge chairs until it was time to board their flight. Flying couldn't have been easier, Hannah decided as she sipped the glass of orange juice that the stewardess had brought for her. Of course, Ross had prearranged everything for them, and that was the reason they hadn't experienced the delays and frustrations that plagued other airline passengers. All it took was money, he'd assured her, and Hannah was beginning to believe it. So far, their journey home had been worry-free, and there was no reason to expect that the rest of the trip would be any different. The liftoff was smooth and uneventful, even though Hannah had reached for her husband's hand when the engines had revved up and the plane had begun to move down the runway. The co-pilot had just announced that they had reached cruising altitude, and they were now allowed to turn on their electronic devices. Since Hannah didn't have any electronic devices, and she probably wouldn't have used them even if she'd had them, she closed her eyes and let the smooth sound of the engines lull her to sleep. Wake up, Cookie. We're on approach. Ross's voice roused Hannah from a dream filled with duck appetizers quacking and spinning on the tips of the miniature waffle cones that held them. Except for the spinning and the quacking, it had been a replica of the appetizer they'd eaten at the ship's French bistro restaurant the previous evening.
I think I can make them stop quacking if I eat them, she told Ross groggily.
Make what stop quacking?
The duck appetizers.
Ross reached out to hug her. You're still dreaming, honey.
Oh.
Hannah took a moment to think about that.
You're right. I was dreaming about the dinner we had last night on the ship. Everything was delicious.
Yes, it was.
Ross reached across her and pulled a tray from the console between them.
You're probably hungry. I ordered something for you before I woke you.
Hannah looked at him in surprise. Isn't it too late for a meal? I thought we were landing.
We won't land for another 25 minutes, and the stewardess is making a pot of fresh coffee for you.
I thought you might need it before we landed.
Hannah smiled gratefully.
Thanks, Ross. I do need something to wake me up. I'm still a little groggy.
Here you are, Mrs. Barton, the stewardess said as she delivered Hannah's coffee. Just let me know when you need a refill.
Hannah thanked her and took a sip of her coffee before she turned back to Ross.
I wonder if anyone will meet us at the airport.
I don't think so. I ordered a car to pick us up and take us to Lake Eden, but it wouldn't surprise me if your family is waiting for us when we get back to the condo.
You're right. They'll probably be there. Hannah gave a little sigh.
You won't be glad to see them?
It's not that. Of course I'll be glad to see them. But I was looking forward to being alone with you and Moisha and settling back into some sort of a normal routine.
We'll do that, honey. Don't worry. But your family missed you, and they'll want to welcome you home. And then there's your mother.
Right, Hannah sighed, admitting the inevitability of having company their first night home. Mother will want to tell me all about Tori Bascom's murder.
Naturally. And your sisters will want to hear all about our honeymoon cruise. That's why I was glad that you got some sleep on the plane.
Then you knew my family would be there when we got home?
No, I guessed they'd be there. It just seemed like something they'd want to do.
You're right, Ross. They'll probably bring dinner or lunch or whatever. What time is it, anyway?
Ross glanced at his watch.
It'll be close to 5 by the time we collect our luggage and get back to Lake Eden.
Dinner, Hannah said. I hope they don't want to take us out. I'd rather just grab something at home.
Then it'll be pizza, hamburgers, or Chinese. There's not a huge choice of takeout cuisine in Lake Eden.
True, but that's okay. I had enough fancy meals on the ship to last me for at least a month, maybe longer. I can tell them about the meal last night. It was spectacular, especially with the view. I wish we had some photos of the ship and the shore excursions to show them. The only one I have is the photo of us that you bought from the photographer on the sailboat.
Ross smiled.
It's okay. I've got plenty. I made up a slideshow of them while you were sleeping, and I have a cable that I can hook up to your television set so that everyone can watch them. You can give them a running commentary.
Or you can, Hannah smiled at him fondly. You're the photographer, not me. The only photo I took was a selfie with my cell phone.
I'm sure they'd like to see that one, too.
No, they wouldn't. I held the phone too low, and I cut off the top of my head.
Once they'd landed, retrieved their luggage, and were met by the limo, the trip back to Lake Eden was uneventful, and they turned in at the condo complex much sooner than Hannah dreamed was possible. As the limo passed the guest parking area, Hannah noticed that her sister Andrea's car was there. Doc's car was parked right next to it, and she was sure that her mother would be with him. Hannah turned to Ross.
Looks like you're right. Their cars are here.
Told you, Ross said. And there they are.
Hannah took a deep breath as she saw that her whole family was gathered at the base of the staircase that led to her second floor condo.
Michelle and Doc are holding takeout bags, and Andrea has something in a box.
I guess they thought we'd be starving, Ross said as he helped her out of the limo.
Not really. It's just that since they didn't arrange it with us ahead of time, and they didn't want to impose on us, they brought food for everyone. It's a very Midwestern thing to do, but you probably already know that. After all, you grew up here in Minnesota.
Yes, but my father wasn't from the Midwest, so it was different in my family. If we visited someone, we brought vodka.
Ross pressed a tip into the limo driver's hand, took Hannah's arm, and walked her over to where her family was waiting.
Hello, everyone. We're home.
Thank goodness for that,
Dolores exclaimed, rushing forward to take Hannah's other arm.
There's a surprise wedding gift waiting for you inside the condo. We'll follow you, but we want you to go in first.
Is Moishe inside? Hannah asked, eager to see her pet.
Not yet. Norman called to say he was on his way, and Mike and Lonnie should be here in a bit. They wanted to give you a little time to get settled before they brought the rest of the meal.
The rest of the meal? Hannah asked, looking at the two large takeout bags.
Yes. Mike and Lonnie are bringing pizza, and Norman's bringing drinks for everyone. We'll do everything, dear. You won't have to lift a finger, I promise.
I believe you, Hannah said, turning to smile as her mother dropped back to follow them up the stairs. What do you think our surprise is? Ross asked in an undertone as they walked up the stairs together.
I don't know, Hannah answered in the same low tone of voice, and I'm a little afraid to guess.
When they reached the landing, Hannah handed Ross the key.
Here, you unlock the door.
I will, and then I'll carry you across the threshold.
Hannah laughed. You don't have to go that far. It's not like I haven't been inside before.
True, but I'd like to, if you don't mind. Is that all right?
Of course it's all right, Hannah said, secretly delighted at his traditional gesture.
Ross unlocked the door and opened it. Then he lifted Hannah into his arms.
Ready? He asked her.
Yes.
Hannah wrapped her arms around his neck, and he carried her across the threshold.
What in the world?
Hannah gasped. She was so amazed by what she saw, she almost lost her hold around his neck. For one brief moment, she wondered if Ross had unlocked the door to the wrong condo.
Wow!
Ross exclaimed, and it was clear that he was just as surprised as she was.
Look at that flat screen. It's got to be 90 inches, maybe more.
They redecorated the whole living room.
Hannah's voice was shaking with shock as Ross set her down on the floor.
Look at this beautiful new carpet.
And look at those couches. There's three of them, and it looks like the chairs recline. There's seating for six. We can invite your family over to watch videos.
Ross took Hannah's arm to lead her to the couches, but she pulled back.
Wait, I need to look at the kitchen.
Hannah hurried to the kitchen doorway and flicked on the lights. Everything appeared to be exactly as she'd left it. She breathed a sigh of relief and began to smile.
It's the same.
Did you hope they'd put in new appliances?
No, my kitchen is exactly the way I want it. I'm really glad they didn't decide to change it.
You can thank me for that, a voice said behind her, and Hannah turned to see Michelle. I told Mother she'd be taking her life in her hands if she did anything to your kitchen.
Thanks, Michelle. Hannah threw her arms around her youngest sister and hugged her. I can't believe you all got together and refurbished the living room.
Dolores arrived in the doorway and stood there, smiling at Hannah.
I hope you like your new living room furniture, dear.
And your new carpeting, Andrea added, coming up behind Dolores. I picked out the color. It's called Autumn Leaves, and it's shades of browns and reds, like autumn leaves.
It's beautiful, Hannah glanced at Andrea, who was still carrying the box in her arms. What's in there, Andrea?
A new Christmas cookie for you. It's a whippersnapper cookie, and Grandma McCann loves them.
Hannah smiled at her sister. If Andrea's live-in nanny and housekeeper loved Andrea's cookies, they must be superb. Grandma McCann was a great baker in her own right, and Hannah had gotten several recipes from her. What makes them Christmas cookies? She asked, knowing that Andrea wanted to brag about her new creation.
They're green and red, and those are the Christmas colors. I made them with pistachio pudding, and I put in a little green food coloring. I've got dried cherries inside, but I didn't think that was enough color, so I put a half maraschino cherry on top of each one.
Sounds great, Hannah told her. Are we going to try them tonight?
Yes. We're all having dinner together.
Unless you two are too tired, Doc added quickly.
Not at all, Hannah reassured them. Ross, you're not too tired to have dinner with everyone, are you?
No. and I'm getting a little hungry.
Then we'll eat just as soon as you see the rest of the condo and everyone else gets here, Dolores decided for all of them. She turned to Andrea and Michelle. You girls set the table, and Doc and I will show Hannah and Ross everything else.
Wait, Hannah said, glancing down at the beautiful carpeting again, and noticing that it appeared to stretch all the way down the hallway. Did you carpet the whole condo?
Everything except the kitchen and the bathrooms, Andrea told her. I had them stretch it nice and tight so that Moisha can't hide anything under the carpet anymore.
That's good, Hannah said, remembering the old green carpeting that had come with the condo when she'd purchased it. Moisha had torn it loose in several places so that he could hide his toy mice in a nice, safe place to retrieve for later enjoyment.
Wait until you see the master bedroom, Doc said, slipping his arm around Dolores's waist. Your mother picked out the bedroom set, but I put my foot down when she wanted to give you a Delft blue bedroom with puffy white curtains and French provincial furniture.
That furniture was beautiful, and you know it, Dolores contradicted her husband. She attempted to glare at him, but her lips turned up in a tiny smile that let everyone know she was teasing. She turned back to Hannah and Ross. You two should be very grateful to me.
Why is that, Mother? Hannah asked, noticing that her mother looked even more amused.
My dear husband wanted you to have a bed made out of logs, with grizzly bears carved on the bedposts. They looked like they were ready to tear someone into little pieces, and I just knew you'd have nightmares every night if you had to sleep in that bed.
Come on, Lori. Doc Knight gave her arm a pat. It wasn't as bad as you're describing it. The whole bedroom set was designed by a renowned chainsaw artist. It had acorns for knobs on the dresser drawers, squirrels chasing each other on the mirror frame, and that bed was unique. Not another one like it. It was one of a kind.
I heard the salesman tell you that, but one of a kind doesn't mean it's good. It just means the man with the chainsaw didn't think he could sell more than one of them.
Doc laughed and put his arm around Dolores again.
You could be right, dear. Those bears were a bit menacing.
Then he turned back to Hannah and Ross.
We compromised and went for a Mediterranean look. Your mother saved you from marauding bears, and I saved you from spindly chairs and gilt-edged curlicues.
Not to mention the horrors of the French Revolution, Hannah said, getting into the spirit of things. It really was good to see her family again, and the wedding gift they'd given her was truly amazing. It was almost too much to take in all at once, but she knew she'd have plenty of time to appreciate each and every thoughtful touch they'd made in the days to come. And tonight, after everyone had left, they'd sleep in a new bed, in a new bedroom, to start their new life in Lake Eden together. Spumoni Whippersnapper Cookies. Do not preheat oven yet. This dough has to chill. One box, approximately 18 ounces, white cake mix, the kind that makes a 9-inch by 13-inch cake. I used Duncan Hines Classic White. One package instant pistachio pudding mix. I used Jell-O, the kind that makes 4 half-cup servings. One large egg, beaten. Just whip it up in a glass with a fork. Several drops of green food coloring, if desired. 2 1/2 cups of thawed Cool Whip. Measure this. A tub of Cool Whip contains a little over 3 cups, and that's too much. 1/2 cup chopped pistachio nut meats. Measure after chopping. 1/2 cup chopped dried cherries. I used Mariani brand. 1/2 cup powdered confectioner's sugar. Small jar of red maraschino cherries cut in half vertically and without stems. Hannah's first note. Notice that the measurement for the Cool Whip is different in this whippersnapper recipe. That's because of the added dry pudding mix. It's 2 1/2 cups of thawed Cool Whip. Hannah's second note. If you can't find pistachio nut meats, don't bother cracking all those pistachios. Just use chopped pecans, walnuts, or almonds instead. The taste will be different, but it will be good. Hannah's third note. If you can't find dried cherries, you can use cherry-flavored craisins instead. Pour the dry white cake mix into a large bowl. Add the dry pistachio instant pudding mix. Mix until the dry ingredients are well combined. I used a fork to do this. Use a smaller bowl to mix the 2.5 cups of Cool Whip with the beaten egg. Add the green food coloring if desired. Mix until everything is combined, but don't overmix. Fold in the chopped dried cherries and the chopped nuts. Mix well, but very gently. Add the Cool Whip mixture to the cake and pudding mixture in the large bowl. Stir very carefully with a wooden spoon or a rubber spatula. Stir only until everything is combined. You don't want to mix all the air out of the Cool Whip. Cover your bowl of dough and place it in the refrigerator for at least 2 hours. This will make it less sticky. If you try to form the cookie dough balls right now, they'll stick to your fingers and be very difficult to roll. Hannah's fourth note. Andrea said she sometimes mixes whippersnapper dough before she goes to bed on Friday night, sticks it in the refrigerator, and bakes her cookies with Tracy on Saturday morning. Andrea's first note. If it's close to Christmas time and you're planning to make these cookies for Christmas, add a few more drops of green food coloring to the Cool Whip mixture so that your cookies will be Christmas colors. Red from the cherries you'll place on top of each cookie, and green from the food coloring in the dough. When your cookie dough has chilled and you're ready to bake, preheat your oven to 350 degrees Fahrenheit and make sure the rack is in the middle position. Do not take your chilled cookie dough out of the refrigerator until your oven has reached the proper temperature. While your oven is preheating, prepare your cookie sheets by spraying them with Pam or another nonstick cooking spray, or lining them with parchment paper. Place the confectioner's sugar in a small, shallow bowl. You will be dropping cookie dough into this bowl to form dough balls and coating them with the powdered sugar. When your oven is ready, take your dough out of the refrigerator. Using a teaspoon from your silverware drawer, drop the dough by rounded teaspoonful into the bowl with the powdered sugar. Roll the dough around with your fingers to form powdered sugar-coated cookie dough balls. Hannah's fifth note. This is easiest if you coat your fingers with powdered sugar first and then try to form the cookie dough into balls. When your fingers get covered with dough, simply wash them off under running water. It also helps if you put no more than one dough ball in the powdered sugar at a time. It gives you more room to roll, and it keeps unrolled dough balls from sticking to each other. Place the sugared cookie dough balls on your prepared cookie sheets, no more than 12 cookies on a standard size sheet. If you haven't already done so, cut your maraschino cherries in half and place one half, rounded side up, on top of each cookie ball on your baking sheet. Andrea's second note. Make only as many cookie dough balls as you can bake at one time, and then cover the dough and return it to the refrigerator. I have a double oven, so I prepare 2 sheets of cookies at a time. Bake your Spumoni Whippersnapper cookies at 350 degrees Fahrenheit for 10 to 12 minutes. Test for doneness by tapping them lightly with a finger to see if they're set. Let your cookies cool on the cookie sheet for 2 minutes, and then move them to a wire rack to cool completely. This is a lot easier if you line your cookie sheets with parchment paper. Then all you have to do is grab one end of the parchment paper and pull it, cookies and all, onto the wire rack. Once the cookies are completely cool, store them between sheets of waxed paper in a cool, dry place. Your refrigerator is cool, but it's definitely not dry. Yield 3 to 4 dozen soft, chewy cookies. Your yield will depend on cookie size. Chapter 4. Hannah heard someone coming up the outside staircase, and she hurried to open the door. It was Norman, and he was carrying 2 kitty crates. "Hi, Norman. I'm so glad you're here. Come in." Norman stepped in and immediately set the two kitty carriers down on the rug.
"They're not too happy about being in the carriers," he told her.
"They never are," Hannah said, noticing that both Moisha and Norman's cat Cuddles looked less than happy in their crates.
"You're home, Moisha," she greeted her pet.
Even though she hadn't mentioned it to Ross, she'd missed Moisha the whole time they'd been gone. Moisha gave her a pathetic look behind the screen of his crate. Then he yowled the most plaintive yowl that Hannah had ever heard.
"Sorry about that, big guy," Norman said to Moisha. "You'll be out of there in just a minute."
He waved at the others assembled at the table and turned back to Hannah.
"Mike and Lonnie will be here in a couple of seconds. They were pulling in just as I reached the top of the stairs."
Moisha gave another yowl, and Hannah put her hand on the crate, preparing to let him out.
"Sit down, everyone," she warned her family. "Moisha wants out, and I'm not quite sure where he's going to run first."
Then she turned to Norman. "If you let Cuddles out at the same time, maybe it won't be as hectic." As Hannah waited, Norman prepared to raise the wire grate on his crate.
"Okay. Ready? Set, go!"
Hannah and Norman raised the two screens at the same moment, and the cats rushed out. To Hannah's surprise, Moisha didn't race down the hallway as he usually did when he was released from his carrier. Instead, he made a beeline for Hannah and jumped up into her arms. Even though Hannah was ready, she still had to take a step backwards. Luckily, she caught her balance.
"Are you all right, Hannah?"
Ross asked, hurrying to her side.
"I'm fine,"
Hannah replied, nuzzling the top of Moisha's furry head.
"I don't know about you, but I'd say Moisha missed you," Norman commented.
"I guess he did,"
Hannah gasped, still recovering from the 23-pound orange and white bundle of feline that she'd managed to catch.
"Do you want me to take him?"
Ross offered, realizing that Hannah was a bit short on breath.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.